Well, thank you for the opportunity to be here today, and it's my first involvement with ICD, but when Mark contacted me and asked me if I'd be interested to talk, now that I find, having retired from politics, I've got a lot more time on my hands, I couldn't have thought of a better place to come. So to you, Mark, and the members of the Cultural Policy Institute, thank you for the opportunity and for the important work that you're doing. And it's a pleasure to see so many young faces here engaging in this area of cultural diplomacy. If I was making this speech in Australia, I would also be acknowledging at the outset the traditional owners of the land on which the speech was being made, together with their elders, both past and present. This acknowledgement in Australia has now become customary in speeches and events, as well as what's called a welcome to country. In its own way, it's playing a small but important role in cultural diplomacy between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Australians by acknowledging a fundamental truth that was denied for centuries, that Australia was not terra nullius when white man arrived. We were then, and are now, home to the oldest living culture on earth. And following a High Court decision in 1993, rejecting terra nullius, not only is native title now recognised, but we celebrate our Indigenous heritage. This recognition has been an important start to healing and to the healing and reconciliation process, and with it has also become a pride and significance in the diversity of our Indigenous heritage. Interestingly, that oldest living culture on earth has also brought Australia to the world through some of the most exciting new art forms on earth. The highly regarded art forms, these are acknowledged in many of the engagements I've had in ministerial roles in the last few years. Many ministers expressing real interest in how Indigenous cultures are enriching Australian cultural life. Increasingly, though, countries are realising the significance of cultural diplomacy. This institute has been a key driver in that. And I was pleased, for example, to see the EC last year recognise the importance of culture and the creative industries in its common strategic framework to advance the socio-economic development of regions across the EU. Personally, I came to understand the importance of cultural diplomacy not only as Minister for the Arts, but also as Minister for Trade. Then, our involvement in the Shanghai Expo and our year of cultural programs, for example, in India, Vietnam, and China, demonstrated the opportunities through our cultural connections. The Chinese Year of Culture in June 2011, with some 2,000 guests and coverage on CCTV, it closed a year later at the Sydney Opera House with a wonderful performance of the Opera Warriors. And the year before saw our Year of Culture in China. It produced some fantastic breakthrough collaborations in film, dance, and theatre, and opened up China to our Indigenous works. 2 years of the most extensive cultural exchange in the 40 years since our recognition of China came at the same time as China becoming our largest trading partner and our two countries strengthening both their diplomatic and security relationships. Most ministerial visits have also had me at the Hard Rock Cafe in Mumbai, at the Biennale in Venice, and at Digital Games Studios in Brisbane, Australia, all attracting international attention, all involving incredibly talented young people, mostly young people, and all helping diversify our economic base, and most importantly, all building lasting personal relationships and creating for a better understanding. The value of cultural diplomacy to us was also apparent in 2009-10 in helping repair Australia's image in India due to the fallout from incidents in Australia involving Indian students. Amongst the many initiatives was a concert in Australia by Indian composer A.A. Rahman and joint efforts through film, radio and television involving creative collaboration by Australian and Indian artists. Cultural diplomacy too has been recognised in Australia as having a crucial role to play, most recently documented in the release of Australia's white paper on our engagement in the Asian century. This white paper places heavy significance on the importance of cultural diplomacy. It recognises such engagement must be built on relationships, not merely transactions, that cultural connections can be a powerful force in bringing people together, and that our success in Asia is as much through our cultural links as it is our economic ones. It also recognises that public diplomacy, which includes cultural diplomacy, has traditionally been defined as actions taken by government. But in recent times, with social media and new and converging media technology and the proliferation of interest groups, a broader definition is now required, as well as a better appreciation of its effectiveness. It's the people-to-people dimension of these groups and the proliferation, availability and reach of the multimedia platforms that presents so many new, exciting and creative areas to engage. Acknowledged also is that public and cultural diplomacy help to start conversations, share knowledge and are capable of conveying more nuanced messages. Now, global problems require global solutions, but arriving at those solutions must take into account national and regional variations. Localism is becoming increasingly more important and is essential to understand in the context of globalisation because localism is founded on the people-to-people relationships in local communities. The sustainability of these solutions, however, lies not just in stronger people-to-people relationships, but also in partnerships. People-to-people relationships create a better understanding and through it, a commitment to a solution. They not only put a human face to the problem, they humanise the issue, creating the environment for addressing the problem from the perspective of what's best for humanity, not just what's best for the country. Not every country and culture has the same set of values, so it's as important to understand where we are different as well as what we share. Our arts and cultural institutions, as well as our cultural celebrations, provide not only a meaningful point, but neutral territory, a place and an opportunity to explore those differences with respect and with safety, and in doing so, also discovering through shared interests the common ground. The partnership dynamic shares the burden. It creates a mutual commitment to solve. It's based on an honest assessment of the problem, and without the development of partnerships, we quite frankly end up with buck passing, we fall into the blame game, and we resort to simplistic assessments of the problem to suit domestic audiences. Cultural connections can be a powerful factor in bringing these people together, to build those relationships and to forge the partnerships. Now, our cultures, they define us. It shapes our values of pride, inspiration, respect, and tolerance. Cultural diplomacy is based on the premise that using those values and drawing that strength from what has developed and shaped us can transcend political and border differences. Engagement through this prism opens a dialogue based on shared values and respect a built trust that can help address seemingly intractable problems. Now, in addition to the commitment to the role of cultural diplomacy recognised in the white paper that I talked about, Australia's engagement, we've also recognised the importance of culture, the arts and the creative industries to us as a nation, and the need to invest in the arts and culture. In March this year, we released Creative Australia, a national cultural policy, the first in almost two decades. It's a bold statement that sees the artist at the centre of a creative society and creativity at the centre of our future in the global economy. It recognises the importance of governments continuing to invest in the arts because it's an investment that produces important dividends. A social dividend through values such as freedom of expression, essential to a healthy democracy, through the structures and disciplines that the arts are founded upon, the values of inclusion, of teamwork, of tolerance, of respect, and of integrity. But there's also an economic dividend, because a creative economy is a more productive one and a more competitive economy. Innovation needs creativity. It needs design. It needs structure. And creativity is an economic force because it's more than just adapting technology. It's being ever more creative in its use. Creative Australia is a statement also of pride and strength drawn from our diversity. I've mentioned before Australia's vibrant culture underpinned by home to the oldest living cultures on earth. But it's also been a country that's welcomed the greatest diversity of cultures on earth. Multiculturalism has given Australia a rich mosaic of settler cultures. The Creative Australia policy was also built around extensive stakeholder involvement from the beginning, aimed at building ownership and advocacy in the result. And it was a policy also built on the partnerships of governments, of business, and of not-for-profit organisations and stakeholders. Partnerships not only built around sharing the funding, but sharing also the experience. Now, this too was a lesson from my trade days. To make any of the advances that we made in the free trade area, it was essential to build personal relationships at the political level. Government-to-government relationships could not be just built through officials and then the formalisation through the politicians. The politicians, in my view, have to be far more effectively engaged, but it requires more than that. It also requires that stakeholder engagement. And whilst we've established B2B business relationships on top of the G2G, government to government, and if you like, NGO to NGO, it's not sufficient to have those engagements at the personal level just amongst themselves. We have to join the dots to get the shared experience and the common objective going forward. But the policy of which I speak was also an example of joining the dots within government, because other key policy areas to the arts and culture go to education and training, industry and design, Indigenous affairs, social inclusion, regional policy, multicultural affairs, communications and technology convergence, and all of these build on and impact our cultural richness. This identification of the key linkages was essential to build the partnership of support within government for the policy and, importantly, for the necessary financial commitment, which isn't easy in a fiscally constrained environment. But it also served to remind my colleagues that the arts and the creative industries are not a silo alone to be funded. They are multifaceted. When others can see the relevance to their domain, they're much more likely to support it. So far as these two documents are concerned, the links are contained at the end of this speech, and I've sent them to Mark, and if you're interested, I'd urge you to read them and keep in touch with me if you have any questions. But given the huge potential of cultural diplomacy to problem solving and the commitment of those associated with this institute to advancing its importance, here are some suggestions as to how we might strengthen the people-to-people and partnership linkages. One, countries and individuals should reassess the importance and value of initiating or refreshing cultural exchange treaties and programs. Two, beyond the overarching treaties and the MOUs, which are normally cast in general terms, look for specific areas of activity around which to forge the relationship. For example, the benefit of co-production treaties in film and radio to convey better cultural understanding, better shared experiences. We're doing this with China, with India and Singapore, but we've also had important collaboration here in Germany with the highly acclaimed film Lore. Third, ensure that within the cultural exchanges, in whatever form they take, opportunities are also created to deliver training and capacity building. The true benefits of collaboration come not only from the performance or the showing in bridging the cultural gap, but also the shared experience and shared learning that results and can result, quite frankly, not just in a better understanding, but in new cultural creative outcomes. Four, in recognising the growing mobility of the education and training market overall, look to link immersed cultural programs into the education experience. Five, build cultural dimensions into sister city and subnational economic relationships. This is an important subset of negotiations around national treaties, but it also recognises that growing importance of localism that I referred to earlier. Six, establish strong national models such as the Goethe Institute, the British Council, the Confucius Institute, to better coordinate, initiate and deliver cultural engagement. Seven, use greater engagement by the national collecting institutions within countries. First, within the nation states through effective coordination and collaboration to give a more holistic cultural understanding and experience. And second, through international exchanges that reinforce shared histories, heritages, cultures, and values. Eight, look to the potential to use faith communities to break down barriers, to dispel misconceptions and seek the solutions. This opportunity is also driven by the existence of so many values and principles which are shared by all religions. For example, the golden rule or law of reciprocity, the do unto others rule, the speak the truth rule, the blessed are the peacemakers rule, or the forgiveness rule, just to name a few. Nine, recognise the arts, like sport, have a huge potential to open doors. They are also the two passions that young people share, and we must be more creative in how we tap those passions and connect them, connecting young people in particular to wider career opportunities and cultural exchanges. And finally, resist cuts to the arts and the creative industries in this fiscally constrained environment, and do this by reinforcing the social and economic dividend of the investment. At the same time, recognise that governments alone can't fund what's needed, so we must look to how existing and new funding can leverage better funding partnerships. So, in conclusion, the challenges we face globally are solvable. The solution rests on a new trust, a trust between those charged with leadership and a trust in the leadership by the public. As diverse as our different cultures may be, they are founded on many common and enduring values, speaking the truth and reciprocity among them. We need to ensure our international structures establish a better factual base to establish the facts that matter. And to help us get to that truth, we need leaders of integrity to tell the truth and to engage accordingly. The Syrian crisis is a timely reminder. There is agreement to stop chemical weapons use, but not a public trust in leadership that a solid enough case has yet been established as to who is responsible for its use. Again, let's get the facts. Use the UN and international diplomacy and the shared cultural values to pursue the case. The lack of trust by the public in leadership is a reflection, I think, of the fallout of the Iraq War. That was a circumstance in which the UN was not allowed to complete its task, the weapons inspection, and in which the coalition of the willing went to war on a lie, not the truth. Now, it's therefore not surprising that the public, through its political processes in both the UK and the US, would not give the necessary license until more evidence is established. But I believe that the personal relationship comes back to the point I was making before about that engagement at the political level. The personal relationship between the US Secretary of State John Kerry and Russian Foreign Minister Lavrov has established an important path forward to deal with the real issue at stake here, the scourge of chemical weapons and the need to prevent their use and hopefully eradicate them. So the lessons are, people-to-people relationships are crucial, the relationship between leaders and with the public must be built on trust and honesty. Those values transcend all faiths and all cultures, and we should never forget the inherent wisdom embedded in us all that our cultural upbringing is the basis for conflict resolution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sir Crean. We thank you for all your thoughts, and we'd like to open the floor now to take some questions. So we start from right or left. Okay.
Good. Thank you for your presentation. It's very interesting and thought-provoking. I'm a basketball coach, and you might think, well, what does that have to do with this subject here? One of my players a few years ago, his name is von Falkenhayn. His great-grandfather was General von Falkenhayn, and he used the first chemical weapons in the First World War against troops, against Allied troops in the First World War. I just wanted to mention that. Germany still has stockpiles of chemical weapons from the First World War. During the lead up to the attack on Iraq, the second attack, ostensibly to get rid of weapons of mass destruction, I was wondering, you know, what about these stockpiles of chemical weapons, and indeed weapons of mass destruction in Germany? And part of the reasoning for them still existing is the fact that it's too dangerous to get rid of them. One has to think about that. But that's not really what I wanted to ask you. I'm 2 years older than you. I was born in 1947. And In the middle of late 50s, I saw a movie. It's called On the Beach. And if, for those people who don't know what On the Beach is all about, it was a very famous book, well-read, bestseller. And it's a story of a crew, an American submarine crew, who is coming to Australia. And they're just a little bit ahead of an atomic cloud that's following them, and that will eventually envelop the Earth. And there's a lot of drama in this story. I'd like to ask you, you know, sometimes movies will in some way reflect reality. Now that we've had the terrible accident at Fukushima, that cloud is indeed a reality. And it is going eastward across the Pacific. It has already gone across Australia on its way to California and points there further. What is your perspective on that? We're talking about people, partnerships, problem solving, and culture. That's a big problem in that region right now. I was just looking on the internet. There's a study that was issued by the Australian Radiation Protection and whatever agency. And this was before the revelations that there are now 300 tons of radiated water flowing into the ocean every day since the accident happened. My question is, what is your perspective on this problem in terms of solving the resolution of that problem, the dangers that are incurred, and what impact will that have and is having right now?
Well, the point I would make about the On the Beach film, Ava Gardner was known to have remarked when she came down to star in that film, she said, "Where else would be a better place to film the end of the world than Melbourne, Australia?" Now, that was the 50s. No one thinks that now. So I think that time perspectives do change as people get a better understanding. But to the more serious part of the question, I think it is really important to... I know Germany has banned future nuclear development in the wake of the Fukushima fallout. But I don't believe that that can be done by all countries that are facing growing demand for energy, and particularly in circumstances in which we're telling them that they should be looking to more sustainable energy solutions. Now, going for sustainability is one thing. Safety is the first priority. I think that despite the accident and the setback, it's essential to work on the science and the technology to perfect the problem. And I think that countries like ours, even though we're not in a position to need nuclear energy anytime soon, although that's a valid debate going on in our country. We have large supplies, not just of coal, but of gas, and we're moving heavily into the renewable energy space. But countries such as China, which has got enormous expansion, as well as India, these are countries that have themselves committed to not being able to meet their energy needs unless they're also allowed to develop nuclear. I think countries like ours, which are not going nuclear but have large supplies of uranium, as does Canada, for example, there's an obligation to try and put pressure on two fronts: the safety of how it's used and to work collaboratively to achieve that, and obviously to ensure the non-proliferation, the non-use, if you like, into weapons activity. This obviously is a big issue going on at the moment because of Iran, but it was recently an issue that was resolved in the case of India, who are not signatories to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, but for whom provision has been made through the US Congress and which we've supported, and that is to provide uranium for civil purposes. So I think this is a very complex area. But simply because the accidents happen, I don't think the solution is to simply cut it off. Yes, you've got to halt things, you've got to assess them, you've got to work out what needs to be done, but I'm convinced that science and technology does have the capacity to resolve these things, and given the global expansion and the huge demand, not just in the world for food security, but energy and resource security, you can't be on the one hand saying to countries, develop, expand, become more self-sufficient, lift your people out of poverty, and at the same time deny them the means by which they can meet their energy needs.
Actually, I have a lot of questions, but I'll take one, and then we'll give the chance to the... Of course, Australia is one country which is one of the good models for cultural diversity and intercultural relations. What are the challenges that's facing Australia? Is there any black swan to be anticipated that could surface and change that, or is the country's is heading toward more of stability in that direction?
Well, I don't... It's an interesting concept, stability. I think a country has to remain fluid. It has to remain dynamic. Its strength and its future, its opportunity, is going to be secured by diversifying, not staying stable. I think Australia is in the fortunate position, not just because it has a resource base. We're not the only country that has a resource base. Africa has huge resources. There are huge resources in Asia, for example, in the Philippines. It's the efficiency and safety and sustainability with which you extract those resources that becomes important and crucial. So the export service, in my view, and therefore the future to us, is not just in the export of the commodity, but the services that can assist, as with other countries. It's not just technology transfer, it's the know-how and the creativity that go to extracting efficiently, safely, sustainably, and in a lot of cases now, recognising the land ownership claims, the competing land ownership claims. We've had to deal with this in our country. I mentioned before of that High Court decision in 1993, but we've had 20 years experience now of dealing with shared usage, recognising another title. This is increasingly an issue in the African development countries, land use. Interestingly, it's a big issue with environmentalists too. If we talk coal seam gas and the extraction of that and the impact on agricultural land. Again, I think that the solution to these problems is built around establishing the facts, and the science is important. We're investing a lot in establishing the science in those fields. And so I suppose they're the challenges to us as an economy. There, in my view, is nothing we can't do, but unless we're prepared to be bold and innovative and creative and open to ideas and the rest of the world, we will sort of stand still rather than advance. I don't think it's any coincidence that Australia was the only developed country in the world to have avoided the global recession. And it wasn't just because of stimulus. It was because we opened our economy to structural change in the 80s, some tough decisions that really transformed the economy. We're going through another transition now, and we've got to keep ahead of that pace. On the social front, I think that the potential problem is turning in on ourselves and seeing that our future is in remaining a stable population rather than a growth population. I think immigration has unequivocally been good for our nation, good economically, good socially, good culturally. We have become what we are because we've embrace that diversity. We're having an issue, like a number of countries, around asylum seekers at the moment. And the world has a huge issue with asylum seekers because there are so many trouble spots in which people are seeking a genuine asylum. But our difficulty in our country, and this is a debate that really we've tried to address politically on our own. Australia alone can't solve this problem, but Australia as a leader in a regional solution, a global solution, using the United Nations High Commission for Refugees, therein, I think, a solution lies. But I think that the future for countries is being confident about themselves, believing in themselves, and not being frightened about the outside influences, looking for the opportunities, understanding the global dynamic and where you can position yourself. But it's got to have an economic as well as a social balance built into it.
Alex, I'm a French student from Paris. Thank you for your speech. I was curious to have your opinion about the election of Mr. About one month ago, I think that it was a surprise in Australia, and so yeah, I just wanted your opinion about this candidate, and yeah.
Well, I'm biased because I didn't think much of him. He's on the other side of my party, but I must say, I think I'm not surprised that you were surprised at the outcome. Because a country like Australia that has had strong economic growth, strong employment growth, strong growth in real wages, keeping inflation under control, keeping interest rates low, having a low debt to GDP, all of the indicators that every other country would die for, quite frankly, and yet the government of the day loses the election. The election loss was not a surprise in Australia. And this comes back to the issue of domestic politics. It's also the fundamental truth in politics that politics is, in my view, 90% perception, 10% reality. I wish it were different. I think we would be in a far better position if there was more realism and more, you know, factual base on which people made their judgment, but it's not the case. But we were talking before, and my colleague from Japan, who will be speaking with you, I think tomorrow, his party lost last year in similar circumstances to which my party lost this year. Disunity internally, and when you've got disunity, a lot of white noise is created that crowds out your capacity to get the positive message across. And secondly, the failure to tell the narrative. I don't think we sold in Australia as effectively as the rest of the world perceived us as having done so much better than the rest of the world in circumstances of the global financial crisis and the aftermath. Now, as I say, I don't believe that Australia's strength in resisting all of that and doing well and coming through the other end was simply because we moved quicker on the stimulus. The stimulus was important, the Keynesian economics, but we invested heavily in things such as education, not just to create jobs in construction, but to build for the future, build, you know, empower individuals, build the cleverer society, the smarter, the more skilled society. So it wasn't just the stimulus. I think it was fundamentally the fact that in the 80s, we took the hard structural changes, we reduced tariffs, we went from a floating exchange rate, we gave independence to the Reserve Bank on interest rates, we allowed foreign bank entry, and we dropped trade barriers. We globalised a lot earlier. We had confidence in our ability to compete, not relying on protection and government subsidy so much as becoming competitive, becoming a productive nation. Now, I was head of the trade union movement back in those days, and this was a hard task for us because we had to convince our members to accept wage restraint. Because in those days, inflation driven by wages was holding back the growth of the economy. It was making us uncompetitive. We found a lot of ways to reduce real wages, but at the same time lift real disposable income. Things like universal health care, things like retirement incomes policy, things like tax cuts, things like family payments. So we looked at distributing as part of a government accord other than through the money wages. This was a revolutionary approach at the time because in the 80s, those of you who've studied history, the prevailing economic orthodoxy was Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. It was supply-side economics. It was trickle-down economics. It wasn't a structured intervention that was about competitiveness and growth. So I think that put us in good stead. The other thing that put us in good stead is that we, ahead of most developed countries, saw the significance of Asia. And we engaged with Asia a lot earlier. Now, these are the things that have held us in good stead. My point is that those hard decisions were taken by Labor government. We never told the story in this Labor government why the importance of those decisions mattered and how there was still work to be finished. And when you don't frame the debate in politics, when you allow others to frame it, that's when you get sidelined. And I think those two factors were an important reason for us losing what we should not have lost. So it's an important lesson. It's a sad lesson for us. And my colleague can talk about it from his experience tomorrow. But this is where I think it is important to be open with the Australian public, not try and be glib with the public generally, not try and be glib. Not look for the headline story, but develop a strategic approach and understand that governments can't just flick a switch and turn things around overnight. They have to plan and they have to set a timetable for it. The public, in my view, are prepared to give you time if they understand the reason and they can see that they're making progress. If you get that message right, there can be a lot more success for your political future. We failed that test on a number of fronts, in my view.
If I may, I actually have three questions. They'll ask me the first two connected. First of all, what is cultural diplomacy? And then secondly, regarding, let's say, Australia and its relations with other countries, very often there's a disconnect in the way a country is presented abroad, the way it's perceived abroad, and the reality. So this is related to the first question I had, but how do you think cultural diplomacy could assist in strengthening relationships, let's say, between Australia and other countries, and in maybe bridging the gap sometimes between the presentation and the reality? I mean, the current elections are one example, but how might cultural diplomacy contribute in that area?
Well, Mark, I came here to learn what cultural diplomacy might entail. I have a view about it, but a view that's been brought out of practical experience, and that is, and it didn't just happen when I was in government. My understanding about partnership and stakeholder involvement goes back to my point that I made before about the reforms we made in the 80s when I was in the trade union movement. And you can't, as a trade unionist, kid yourself that you can influence the distribution of outcomes unless you're prepared to be part of the wealth creation exercise as well. And if you're part of the wealth creation, you should, in my view, as a stakeholder, have an influence in the way in which the benefits are distributed. So I've seen the advantage of partnership and stakeholder engagement. I came to office, I think it was read out, I was first Minister for Science and technology, and we established the Cooperative Research Centre program, which was about bringing academia, basic research, together with the commercialisation. Still a program that still remains. And that's the test of good policy when it lasts changes of government. When I was Primary Industries Minister, using stakeholders, farmers and land management groups, to work with us as to how better to sustain the natural resource base and manage scarce issues like water and productivity on the land. The people who understand the industry and the challenge, they are an enormous resource. And so cultural diplomacy to me is understanding the strength of the participant and finding a way to engage with them and develop a shared objective. When I was Minister for Employment, Education and Training, and I had this portfolio when we were in recession, this was over 20 years ago, we had very high levels of unemployment. We were spending a lot of money on subsidy programs to train or to get long-term unemployed into work. But I took the view that there was no point establishing the training objective unless it's what employers wanted. And that varied all around our country, because we're not one, we're a United Nation in the sense that we are a federation and a national capital, but we're also a patchwork economy. And the people who understand the patches better are the participants who live and breathe the patch, the leadership in the patch. So what we did was to establish a mechanism that went out to the employers and said, you tell us what your skill needs are. Because we have, if you like, the supply side of the economic equation, the subsidy, the government contribution. We want to know what the demand is. We want to match that demand and supply. And similarly in the trade portfolio, I've talked of cultural diplomacy as bridging gaps, but really what was fundamentally important in negotiating the free trade agreement with ASEAN was a recognition that within the 10 countries that are ASEAN, they're all at different stages of economic development. So you couldn't have one timetable for reduction that applied across the board, because it would be unfair to those that were behind. You had to have regard to the different stages of economic development. But more importantly, there was no point convincing these countries to open their markets and embrace free trade if they didn't have the capacity to compete. In other words, there had to be either the technology transfer, there had to be the training component, there had to be the engagement with them as to what was going to help them bridge the gap. Now, I think, therefore, Mark, the question of what cultural diplomacy is understanding not the culture that just defines a nation, but understand, and this is prescient now because all countries are understanding that they have enormous opportunity with the global economy and the opportunities in it. They're all going to find different ways to participate in it. The transfer of technology, the platform dissemination, the content, the communications, they've opened up huge, enormous opportunities. Cultural diplomacy to me is understanding the differences as well as the common objective as to where one's heading, and find different ways rather than just the political treaty or the signing document to really get the other side understanding that there's a win in it for them. Now, there can be plenty of examples that you can point to with that, but I also believe that there is great opportunity, and I've always believed this in terms of the EU, that what we needed to do was to work closer with our economic relationships, investment as well as trade, between the EU and Australia. Us as the doorway into Asia, them as the doorway into Europe, for us. Because as much as Asia is fundamental to us, it's not the only market that we are going to participate in. And Europe, which I think has been, you know, a bit behind the game in terms of its engagement with Asia, is looking to newer ways to get in. Now, whether it does it directly through Japan, and I know the arrangements with the EU-Japan free trade agreement, those sorts of things are smart. And they are recognising the cultural difference and the cultural asset, I suppose, that different countries and different strengths bring. So it's finding that, and I think it's the people-to-people, most of all, working through that, finding the common objectives that are that are going to give us our best chance. But there's got to be a proper understanding, and not just try and impose your values, get to understand theirs, their challenges, their strengths, and their barriers, not just try and come in and say, well, do as I say, because it's been good for us. Doesn't work that way.
That's a very good point, and I think there we were discussing with some of the students yesterday the importance for culture diplomacy to listen as opposed to speak. And in that sense, you know, the kinds of culture diplomacy, as you were saying, to really get to know those other cultures are sometimes even more important than those culture diplomacies presenting our own cultures. But my third question for you is related a little bit to what you were saying, however, not on an international level, in a national level. Normally, it's thought that culture diplomacy is something between countries, to bring countries together or foreign cultures together. I would actually argue that within a country, there's a great opportunity for culture diplomacy as well. Not too long ago in Germany, Angela Merkel is known for her famous statement that multiculturalism has failed. There was also the finance minister Sarrazin published a very controversial book where essentially his main thesis is that Muslims can't integrate. And it was actually linking it to genetics in that sense, literally, you know, a racist book. It was immediately condemned by the political class in Germany. However, it was a bestseller in Germany for almost half a year. And Germans bought this all over. It doesn't mean necessarily they agree with it just because they bought it. But the point is, there is work to be done in Germany when it comes to multiculturalism. And I think it's not so clear in Germany, what is German identity? You know, you've got these two big interruptions in the 20th century, in the Second World War, Cold War. What is Germany today? And I think unless you have a clarity there in terms of what is our own identity, it's going to be tough when you have groups that appear to be different. You know, that's maybe a threat. And so I just wanted to ask you, in the Australian context, where I'm less familiar, do you see also opportunities for culture diplomacy within Australia, and if so, what opportunities? And then maybe a related question, what is the model for, or is there a model for multiculturalism in Germany, in Australia, and what is the model? And when I say model, there, you know, we referred also earlier this week to this famous example in the USA of a melting pot, where everything melts together into this boring gray soup, as opposed to the Canadian analogy, which is more this mixed salad, whereas really multiculturalism is a mixed salad, where an olive is an olive, a carrot is a carrot. Just to get your mind going there, you know, if there is a model for Australia, what would that model be, and do you think cultural diplomacy can assist in maybe getting to that model?
I think cultural diplomacy has been essential in what we've become, and I think ironically we embraced it earlier through multiculturalism than we did acceptance of our Indigenous culture. I think the big revelation since the High Court decision that won in 1993 has been the growing acceptance of how significant it is and how important it is to the definition of what we are. In fact, in the development of the cultural policy, what was very pleasing to me is that all of the stakeholders consulted placed as the number one priority the recognition of our Indigenous culture. That's been an important step because we have a huge gap of disadvantage between our Indigenous community. Higher mortality, higher alcoholism, higher illiteracy, higher health problems, all of this. We've pledged to what we call close the gap. And so there is still a huge task ahead of us. But getting acceptance of the pride and the significance and the importance and the opportunity that comes from it. And part of our difficulty has been that we've grown up in the 200-odd years that we've been around from a Western European culture that's used to written records, established farming practices, cultivation, homes. The indigenous population were nomadic, but they were very effective land managers. And this is not known until recently because none of it documented. In fact, the great difficulty in establishing native title was that the High Court had to be convinced that there had been a continuous association with the land. It was only in the case of Torres Strait Islanders, the islands up the top of Australia, that a university professor had sought to document the language in phonetic term, if you like, that became an important part of the record. That's why in the cultural policy I've put money to the development, to the reactivation of Indigenous language programs. I think, you know, if we're serious about recognising culture and the importance, people have got to be able to speak there. They've got to be able to express themselves in their own words. So it's another area where we've got to do a lot of redress. Multiculturalism, though, I think has been a huge success for our country. And we had a political independent political maverick, a person who campaigned on the basis of one nation, keeping Asians out of the country. She stood again in the most recent election and didn't get elected. But it's a bit like the book that you talked about here in Germany, that if you scratch a racist overtone, it's not hard to get support for it. The strength in overcoming this is having something of a bipartisan position that rejects racism, that embraces inclusion, and that is strong on the importance of immigration and doesn't seek to make it a political weapon. This is a dilemma for all, but this is, I think, an important role for leadership and strength of leadership. And I personally believe, as I said before in answer to the question, that if we allow ourselves to retreat in on ourselves, we're going to do our brand damage, but I think that we're going to hold the country back. So I think it's important as a person who was brought up to engage, welcome, befriend, understand, tolerate, all of those sorts of things, that value set that we've talked about. It really is important to instill that message and to show the benefits to a society from it.
Thank you very much. Let's give the microphone back to you. This is your chance. Questions and comments. Don't miss the opportunity.
I'm Srem from Armenia, so I'm interested to find out your point of view. How can we develop further our country? Because the country is really in a bad situation, if mildly said. We have a high debt to GDP, and the corruption level is also very high. So, and lately, we just accepted as a member of Eurasian organization that as a friendly country with Russia. The other opportunity was to have signed an agreement with the EU, but we, because Russia is protecting our borders, and because of other reasons, because 80% of our economy heavily depends on Russia, I would say. That's why we decided to take the lead of Russia in this situation. What do you think about this? Like, your point of view is very interesting and very important for me. Thank you.
Well, let me throw it back to you. What do you think should be done, and how would you go about it? How are you going to use this opportunity to bring your knowledge of the problem, drill down to what the fundamentals are if we share a lot of the common values in terms of where we like to go. I mean, first of all, you do have to, corrupted societies always hold back, always end up with elites and a lot of downtrodden. Diversified economic base, understanding your strength, these are all, you know, fairly common sorts of principles, but you know, this comes back to my point about the patchwork nature of our own domestic economy. What is your patch good at? How would you go about it? And what issues do you think need to be addressed? Because that's your opportunity.
Okay, so I was having a research about the export-led industry policy of the Republic of Armenia for 2013 and 2014. It was written that the country is going to develop several sectors, including like diamond and mostly heavily dependent on like natural resource exploitation. So I think this is wrong, because exploiting natural resources is to satisfy for short-term needs, but we need to have a future prospect. We need to think about long-term needs. So because of that, I think that the country should go through the innovation and IT sector, which I again see a gap in the presidency apparatus, because they are not doing proper investments in this field, or even they are doing, they don't have proper management system. We recently opened up this ECA Innovation Center together with Nokia and Windows in Armenia, but I am as a participant there. I have signed up for classes. I don't see public awareness, high public awareness level there. So as a like a resident of Armenia, I think that the country's president should think about this issue. So he should arise this in TV, media, or other sources, I don't know, heavily invest on Facebook, other social media, to create some interest among the people, young people, to go and study IT, which I personally do now, and I want to open my own company and just get enrolled in this IT sector, like game programming, Objective-C programming, and iOS developer now. I took this class. So I think this is the future for Armenia, because we are heavily dependent on foreign direct investment. We cannot be self-sufficient, unfortunately. So what the country needs to do, and immediately, I think, is to heavily invest on the IT sector. Even I think it doesn't make sense for a country. Country invests 80% of its GDP on defense and other stuff. But if Russia is there, and if we have this kind of agreement with Russia, I don't think that it's worth to invest 80%. At least they can invest like 70%. This 10%, as you already mentioned in your speech, then they can invest in education sector, in IT education sector more specifically. I don't know. And the other problem is that I want to also study in Harvard. Now, president provides only 50% for my study there. So good thing would be to cut 10% from the defense and provide for young people who have this ability to go and study in top 10 universities and then come back with their knowledge and experience and educate people there, just open up a business, develop economy, I don't know, diversify the economy, because the economy is not diversified. The economy is heavily dependent on this natural resource exploitation, which is terrible. It will have terrible results. People don't understand. People, villagers, they are just thinking about short-term needs. Oh, I don't have money. I cannot satisfy the needs of my family. I need to do something. So Russia comes and let's exploit this, or the British government comes and let's do this, that. So they don't understand. Because of illiteracy, as you already mentioned, they cannot really grasp the idea. So I think that...
Well, I think you've given an excellent outline as to the way in which it should go. Can I just make a couple of observations? First, I think that I don't see any harm in playing to the strength and exploiting your natural resource capacity, provided you're using or find a way to use the proceeds of that to invest in the diversification that matters. And that can take a number of different forms. I don't know what the other potential industries are. But the best investment the government can make is the one that you've referred to, and that's in the education and training of its people. So I think it is that agitation for that. Governments, well, they don't always have all the answers, but they do make a difference. And governments, especially if they're weighting a fair bit of their expenditure, you know, into the defence industry where it could be better spent elsewhere, that's the issue that has to be taken up at home, quite frankly, because it's the right one.
Also, the government, we are annually having this kind of money collection from our diaspora. In US, they are collecting this money, and it's a quite good amount of money. It's like around $15 million. So there is a tough talk among Armenian scientists and government officials. That's why they don't create this kind of international venture capital funds, so that the people with the head should be from diaspora, because diaspora is not corrupted as the city internally is corrupted. So he can handle these funds and invest in mutual funds, in stock exchanges. Nowadays, we are also going to be included in Eurobonds issuance. But I think it would be better for us to look at this venture capitalism opportunities rather than, again, go to Europe or go to Russia, ask this, ask that. It's better to be self-sufficient. I understand that cultural diplomacy and intercultural relations are so important, but heavily being dependent on this or that country will have a terrible result in the future. You need to think yourself, at least be able to understand what's your needs and be able to tackle them yourself, first of all. Mm. Okay.
I think most of these concerns, I think there are a lot of concerns that all young people also have with different parts. Maybe we can discuss them also. I don't know if there is a session. I think there is a session for contribution, maybe at the last day. And I think it will be also a good opportunity, not just to exchange, it is to exchange these experiences among the young people, and also experiences of countries from different places. And I think that will be an opportunity also for more sort of response, rather than just one response from one place. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank you again, Mr. Crean, for a very interesting speech, and also for valuable comments from your side regarding some of the questions which we received. Thank you very much. Okay.